Hey everybody!
Hi.
It's Super Breakfast Friends Club. For the first time in 2023.
You probably thought we were dead. And I probably thought we were dead. But here we are, to the chagrin of everyone involved.
Happy New Year, everyone!
Happy the end of the last year, and welcome to this new and horrible year.
I'm still Mike.
I'm currently not Mike.
And welcome to the show where this is happening right now.
Welcome to the show where we confound our audience as much as we confound ourselves and science.
And as much as we are confounded by the 90s and its televisual experiences. Speaking of one of those, here's an opening theme.
Time it's Mega Man.
What did you think of the song? I hated it.
I loved it. I loved it so much. It was the dumbest thing I've ever heard, and I loved it.
They really just like wrote one sentence and then just looped it.
It really epitomized the spirit of the 90s. The spirit of 90s cartoons and that grimdark action era. I loved it.
Yes. It was fun, and I hated it. It was really bad.
I loved it. It got stuck in my head for a while, and then I promptly forgot about it.
It's still stuck in my head, but
good.
Yeah, I noticed you titled your notes after it.
I did no such thing.
So, Mega Man, or Rock Man, as it's known in Japan.
Or the Blue Bomber.
The Blue
Bomber. As he's known in our hearts.
Yep, that's true. The first game was released in 1987 for the Nintendo Entertainment System.
And people are still mad about it.
It was made by Capcom. I didn't know this, but this is apparently the first game they designed for the home market.
Oh.
Up until now, or up until 1987, they had been focusing on arcades. And every home console game they'd released was just a port of one of their arcade games. But this is the first one where they designed it from the ground up with a console in mind.
This is like, how do we take the experience of getting furious at the arcade and bring that into people's homes?
Exactly. And if there's any game that captures that spirit, it's Mega Man.
No, you don't have to keep feeding in quarters, but you do have to pay with little pieces of your soul every time you die before you get to a robot master.
Well, you can now no longer pay with quarters, so even if you're rich, you can't buy your way through the game anymore. So, I was reading about the development of Mega Man. I have here some early titles that were considered for the series. Mighty Kid.
Hate it.
Knuckle Kid.
Love it.
And Rainbow Man.
Love it.
Rainbow Man would have made a lot of sense because he changes colors.
That's true.
The name Rockman, I'm pretty sure came from the Rock, Paper, Scissors inspiration that the game has. Because like each robot master is weak to another one's weapon.
And then Roll just kind of came along for some reason.
Yeah, I think Roll was an afterthought, because she only appears in the end credits of the first game. Apparently she was going to be the damsel in distress at one point, and also at one point they considered having a boss fight against a giant Roll robot.
Okay.
I don't know how that would have come into play.
maybe she would be the paper man, because we've got rock man and we've got cut man, and then she's just a big rolling sheet of paper.
That's true. Now I want there to be a paper man.
Paper Mario. I mean, they've got some pretty wacky robot masters. They got a man that shoots snakes. Why don't we have a man that is paper?
Yeah. Well, what would he do? What's his thing? What's his purpose?
Paper.
Paper.
I thought I made that abundantly clear.
Is Woodman Paper Man?
No, that's Woodman.
Well, maybe if you sliced him up thin enough, he'd become Paper Man.
Paper Man throws paper airplanes at you, and he rolls up like a tube of paper.
Rolls around on the screen.
Yeah. Or he wafts around because he gets caught in a breeze.
Okay, that's perfect. Cut print. Put it in the game. I was looking up. I wanted to know why they changed it from Rockman to Mega Man, because it's a weird change to me. And it turns out that Joseph Morisi, who was the senior vice president of Capcom US at the time, thought the name Rockman was horrible.
It's not the best.
It's fine.
It's fine.
It's... I don't think Mega Man is any better.
I don't know. I kind of like Mega Man.
Do you?
Like, Mega I feel Man. Like it has more punch than Superman. Maybe it's just because it's become synonymous with the Blue Bomber himself. But I feel like Mega Man just, it's got something to it. It's got rhythm to it.
Yeah, maybe. I don't think it says much about who he is, though.
And Rockman does.
Well, yeah, because it's a rock, paper, scissors game.
That tells me nothing. That tells me he either is a rock or he plays in a rock band.
Why can't it be both?
Because that's not how it works.
I guess neither of those are true. So, So Mega Man was created by Akira Kitamura, who left Capcom during the development of Mega Man 3 to join Takeru, where he developed a game called Kokoron, which looked kind of interesting. You build a character out of toy box parts and then play through the game, but it seems like nobody liked it.
Oh. Yeah, I've never even heard of it.
No, me neither. And he retired from video game development in the early 90s, so...
You've killed me, Kokoron!
He doesn't get any credit for Mega Man, because all the credit for Mega Man goes to Keiji Inafune, who was the main artist working on the game. And I've seen a bunch of places in doing my research that credited him with creating all the characters for the first game. But then I've also found interviews where he himself said that a lot of the design work had already been done, or at least started, by the time he joined the team. Apparently, the only character for the first game that he designed from scratch was Elec-Man. So, like, did he create all those characters, really?
We're going to have to hunt the man down and find out.
Okay. You get the tweezers.
What are the tweezers going to do?
We're going to pluck his hairs until he tells us the truth.
Starting with his eyebrows.
We're not giving him a beauty treatment.
Listen, sometimes I just really want to pluck people's stray eyebrow hairs.
Inafune ended up becoming the lead producer of the Mega Man series, and he created most, possibly all, of the alternate universe spin-off series that there are, of which there are many.
Yes.
What we got? We got X, Legends, Battle Network, Zero, ZX, Star Force.
I don't understand any of them. I don't understand any of the canon of Mega Man.
So... from what I understand, there's two timelines. One of them is classic Mega Man, followed by X, followed by Zero, followed by ZX, and then eventually ending with Legends, which is in like a distant future, I think. And then there's a second timeline, which is an alternate universe where people focused on developing AI instead of robots. And then that's Battle Network, which is followed by Star Force.
I keep thinking you're going to say Star Fox.
Yes, Star Fox. That's the next part of the Mega Man. Did you not know?
I didn't.
The Mega Man of the Star Fox series is Rob 64.
He's always giving me a dang bomb instead of something I need.
Oh, I always want the bomb, because unless I've just died and I want my double lasers back.
Yeah, or if you break a wing-a-ling off.
Yeah, but I'm pretty good at Star Fox. So that doesn't happen very often. When it does, I feel like a failure.
You are a failure.
You need to stop telling me that live on air.
I just really want you to internalize it so I don't have to keep saying it all the time.
Oh, it's been internalized. Don't worry about that. I'm going to make everybody think that you're abusive.
You've spent this entire series already doing that.
You make it so easy.
Why is it that everyone in my life paints me as the villain? Should I be concerned? Should I reevaluate? No, it's the children who are wrong.
Everyone in your life. So Inafune became the head of global production of Capcom in 2010, and then left the company later that same year.
Oh.
And formed Comcept, where he made Mighty No. 9.
Oh. Poor Mighty No. 9.
Yeah. He's apparently also known for creating Onimusha, Dead Rising, Mighty Gunvolt, and Recore.
Man, remember the 2000s with Onimusha and Dead Rising?
I remember Dead Rising. I never saw any Onimusha. I don't know anything about it.
My brother played it for a while, but I don't actually know anything about it.
I'm pretty sure there's a show, so we'll look at it eventually.
We're coming for you, Onimusha.
But by the time this show that we're looking at today started, Mega Man 6 was already out, and Mega Man X2 was coming soon. So we're pretty deep in the Mega Mans.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I didn't realize that it took so long for them to... Well, was this the first Mega Man show? Because there's a couple, right?
Yes. I'm not sure if it was this first or if the OVA came first. But one of the... It was either this or the OVA. I'm not 100% sure.
They took this long to give us a Mega Man... And it was this bad?
Well, listen to this. Okay, now we're into the part of my notes which is specifically about the production of the show.
Okay.
And I got some things to say. We've got some revelations for you here.
Oh, no.
So this show first aired September 11th, 1994, in syndication. Already kind of a bad date. I mean, we didn't know it would become a bad date at the time, but...
You can't call it a bad day if it's 8 years before anything happened.
I know. But, like, this show is buildings being destroyed in New York City, and it first aired on September 11th.
That's what everybody did back then. You destroyed New York City. They still do it.
Yeah. I guess
you're
right.
It's the only thing you're allowed to destroy.
If you look at TV, you'd be convinced that that's the world's only city, I think.
It's certainly our only city.
They made two seasons of this, 27 episodes altogether. There was a third season planned, but it got cancelled, despite the show having really high ratings. This was a popular show, apparently.
Okay.
I'd never heard of it at the time. Did you? Were you aware of this show?
I was vaguely aware I was alive by that point.
Yeah, I guess I was pretty small too, but I feel like I would have... Yeah, I would have known if I'd seen this show. 1994, I would have been aware of it. I'm aware of what I was watching in 93. It must have just been on cable or something here, and that's why I never saw it. The decision to cancel it came from Capcom, apparently. And it's speculated to be because of disappointing toy sales. So, like,
nobody wants the Gutsman action figure.
Oh, this show's doing really well in the ratings, and all the kids are watching it, but they're not buying the toys. Cancel it!
We're going to have to stop with the seasonal release of Gutsman's ass.
Oh, I hope everybody knows about the Gutsman's ass video.
Nobody knows about the Gutsman's ass video. That's... YouTube poops haven't been cool for 15 years, Mike.
But we remember it.
We're probably the only people that do.
Yeah. That was like, that's one of the YouTube poops I remember the most of all the ones I've ever seen. Because a lot of the others blend together because they use a lot of the same clips.
It's pretty much the only YouTube poop I remember.
Yeah. Like, I know I watched a lot of YouTube poops of CDI Zelda, but they all blend together because there's so many YouTube poops of CDI Zelda.
Yeah, and there's only so many clips you can use from that game.
Yeah, but that's the only 1994 Mega Man show YouTube poop I ever saw, so that one stands out to me. Anyway, apparently there was one single third season episode that was made and released. But it's generally...
One?
Yeah, just one. But it's generally considered to be a part of season two. So, like, whenever there have been DVDs and stuff released, they always just put that episode as the last episode of season two. Because you can't
put
out...
You're telling me they don't release an entire box for one episode?
Yeah, you can't put out a season three DVD set that has one episode on it. That's not going to fly.
That would be incredible.
The show was made by Ruby Spears, who we've talked about before, because they also made Saturday Supercade.
Oh, yeah, our old friend.
Yeah, made our Frogger and Q-Bert shows that we looked at. This show was one of the last things they ever made, because the studio closed down in 1996.
Probably because of Mega Man.
Mega Man himself. He raided the studio.
Proto Man and his buddies came and wrecked up the joint. Dr. Wily's like, once I control this place for no reason, I'll control the world.
Yeah, what was that about? We'll get to that. We'll get to it. But the show was co-produced by Ashi Productions, who I think handled a lot of the animation, which is why the action stuff looks so nice, because they're a pretty decent anime studio. We've talked about them before because they made F-Zero GP Legend.
Our favorite show.
And they also made Magical Princess Minky Mono.
I knew it! I knew it! Once there was that pregnant pause, I was like, she's back, isn't she?
She's never going to leave.
I can feel her dark presence looming behind me.
We've talked about... I can't believe how much we've talked about Magical Princess Minky Momo over the course of this show.
She's just left her fingerprints throughout history.
Ashi Productions had apparently pitched a Mega Man anime a few years earlier, but it wasn't produced. I don't know why. There's some concept art for it, and it looks pretty good. It looks much. It looks much more like Mega Man.
You mean small and green?
Yeah, that's Mega Man we know. I forgot we have talked about Mega Man before, huh?
We've talked about a Mega Man.
What was it he says? Mega high!
He just croaks at you the whole time.
Yeah. And he was green because the guy who did the character designs had a broken TV or something.
Uh-huh. All he had was just his own TV and game to go off of for art.
For anybody who wants to know more about that Mega Man, go check out our Captain N episode.
Our Captain N episode.
Yeah, part one, Captain N. Because I'm sure there'll be a part two eventually.
We'll be back.
So there's a short pilot episode. Episode isn't quite the right word because it's so short. But there's a pilot animation of this show that was sent out to TV stations to sell it. And I'm mad about it. So it turned up on a VHS tape that somebody found. Watch this, and I think you'll see immediately why I'm mad.
Mega Man, the game produced by Capcom, the premier supplier of interactive cartridges in the world today, has sold over 2.5 million Mega Man cartridges to date, with pre-sales of over 750,000 units for the upcoming SNES version of the next Mega Adventure, leading to an even higher awareness with boys 6 to 12. Mega Man, the toys, by Bandai, the leader in toys in Japan and other Pacific Rim countries, have been hugely successful. Now Mega Man comes to the United States, ready to launch a major licensing program. And the Mega News for 1994, Capcom is bringing you the animated Mega Man story with 13 half-hour episodes, produced by the award-winning action-adventure Ruby Spears Animation Studios.
Oh my god, I love that there's a whole toy pitch within the cartoon pitch.
Oh, of course.
It's pretty cute. It's very stylistic. It's very Mega Man.
Yeah, right? This is the show we could have got.
I'm sorry, are you looking at this delicious warm dish that Mother has served to us and turning up your nose?
This is the, like... I want Mega Man. We have Mega Man at home. Right?
Yeah.
This is the Mega Man I wanted. But we got the Mega Man at home.
This is the plug and play that Grandma got for us.
So I looked into how this happened. Why is it that they made this pilot that uses the designs from the games and looks so much like an actual Mega Man show, and then the show somehow between the pilot and actual production turned into this? And I found my answer.
Mm-hmm.
So Joe Ruby, who we've talked about before, you may remember him as the guy who demanded Qbert be Happy Days.
No! I don't like where this story is going.
He said that they asked Capcom for older, more athletic designs because they thought it would suit their audience better.
Uh-huh.
Apparently, the new designs for the characters that we got in the show were provided by Keiji Inafune. So it's the same guy who designed the characters originally, designing these more America superhero-centric looking versions of the characters.
Yeah.
But I would have preferred they just made it look like the game, personally.
Yeah, me too.
I think every kid who knew what the game was would have preferred that.
Like, he still looks like Mega Man, but it's like, what was that cartoon you were watching where everybody looked like buff babies?
Oh, shoot, what was it? It was Beverly Hills Teens.
Yeah, it's kind of like that. He's got this little baby face and these big swollen biceps.
It is weird. Yeah, it's especially weird on... Later on, when we see Proto Man, he actually does seem to be... When they first build Proto Man, he seems to have little kid proportions. But he still has this
buff
body.
I was very confused by that. I don't know if that's the same Proto Man.
Yeah, me too. It was weird. I don't know, robots grow in this universe, I guess. But anyway, a couple of shots from this pilot were used in the opening for the show, I noticed. But they're all shots of buildings collapsing, and a couple shots
Right, it's not any of the designs.
It's a couple of the designs. Some of the cute robots, where you get like a huge flock of just some of the smaller cute robots flying by. A couple of those shots were used in the opening. Which is funny, because I'm not sure that those robots ever appear in the show. Maybe they do, I don't know.
We've only watched the first episode.
Yeah, I didn't grow up with this show. This is literally my first time watching it outside of a YouTube poop setting. So. The characters that were used in the show were largely dictated by Bandai, who had the license to make the toys.
Mm-hmm.
An executive from Bandai would check the scripts to make sure the toy characters were being used, apparently.
Of course. Why Cut Man?
I don't know. I guess because he's like the Cutman and Gutsman are like the most popular robots from the first game, I think.
Are they?
Who else is in there? I feel like I never see Bomb Man.
No, no one cares about Bomb Man.
Iceman I see sometimes. Gutsman, at least, was like one of the main characters in the Battle Network. He was actually like a protagonist. I don't know. I definitely think of Cutman and Gutsman as the main ones. But, you know, now...
Yeah, what's that got to do with 1994 America? Yeah.
Well, now I'm thinking, like, maybe I think of Cutman and Gutsman as the main ones because of this show. Because they're the only ones who appear in every episode, apparently.
There's a part later that I just died at.
They are... Cutman and Gutsman are basically the scratch and grounder of this show.
Yeah.
Almost.
Identical.
Yes, pretty much. Some of the toys that were dictated to appear in the show didn't actually make it to production, apparently. So there are things in the show that they were told to put in the show because there were toys being made, and then the toys were never made.
Cool.
So that's fun. Anyway, let's actually talk about the show for real now.
Oh boy.
This episode is called The Beginning.
Wow. And how novel.
It's written by Mark Jones, best known as the creator of the Leprechaun horror series.
That's incredible. I love it.
Yeah, I thought you'd like that.
Creator of Leprechaun in the Hood?
Maybe not Leprechaun in the Hood. I'm not sure. I think they're... He wrote three. Let me have a look. No, he did Leprechaun, Leprechaun 2, and Rumpelstiltskin.
Oh, well, he still started this whole mess, so gotta give him some credit.
That's true. Yeah, he also wrote a lot for the A-Team, What's New, Mr. Magoo, Dicky Dog, the Scooby and Scrappy-Doo Puppy Hour, and Superboy.
And this whole time, he's just haunted by visions of a horrible little leprechaun.
Yeah, that was his magnum opus. That's what he had to get out of him.
I gotta get this thing out, man. If I tell, something bad is gonna happen. All these kids shows. I gotta get the leprechaun out.
Mark, are you okay? We've noticed that for every children's show you write, you always provide us with one episode we can't use because it's a horror story about a leprechaun.
Starring Jennifer Aniston.
We're here in this futuristic city, although what makes it futuristic is just that there are monorails everywhere.
Right. It's very loosely futuristic. We're told it's futuristic because there's robots.
Yeah, this is the... I mean, the people who worked on this show will all be people who grew up in, like, the 40s and 50s, probably. So their idea of what's futuristic is monorails. Because they grew up with the World's Fair stuff. So they're like, oh yeah, the monorail. That's the future.
The Springfield monorail.
Yeah, because now we think of the Springfield. Like, those of us who grew up in the 90s, we think of the Springfield monorail.
And those of us who grew up in the 2000s and beyond don't even know what a monorail is.
Yeah. So I actually wasn't certain that this was actually New York at the beginning. I went and looked it up, and it is. It's kind of an odd choice, because Mega Man... I feel like the Mega Man games are set explicitly in Japan, but...
That would make sense.
Yeah.
But it's like Phoenix Wright thing.
Yeah, I don't think they ever actually named the city that it takes place in. It's just like, the city is in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess if you live in Japan, you would probably just assume Tokyo, right?
Yeah.
You know, I actually, maybe I'm completely making this up, but I do feel like in one of the games you can see Mount Fuji in the background.
You can always see Mount Fuji in video games. You can always It doesn't matter where it takes place.
So we're at Kennedy Airport. I guess it's JFK Airport, but it only says Kennedy Airport on the sign.
You know, the thing that we call it all the time over here.
So I'm assuming that this was a mistake at some point, but the airline is called Ruby Airline.
I saw that. So when you said we're at JFK, I was like, that's not what I remember reading.
No, yeah, on the outside of the airport, it says Kennedy Airport, but then we go into the actual airline, which is Ruby Airline. I'm fairly certain it's supposed to say Ruby Airline. And that it's named after Joe Ruby, who owns the studio that made this.
No, it's the Ruby Airline.
It's the Ruby Airline. It's got two B's. I love it. And there's all these weird hovercraft planes. Can you even call them planes? They're like hovercrafts.
I don't know. My favorite part about this opening is, like, we're shown it's the future because there are robots carrying luggage, and there's two robots, and they're like passing the luggage between each other, but the plane is like a foot away. Why do you need two robots to do this job?
I have the same note. Yeah, I really like the design of the baggage handler robots, but one robot could have easily done the job these two are doing.
The pile is right there, and all he does is pass it to another robot standing next to him.
And they are standing literally like hip to hip. It's not like there's a distance. And one of them picks up the bag and just hands it to the other one, who takes the bag and puts it on the cart.
They never move their feet.
So funny. Yeah. But Wily's robots show up. It's Wily's robots.
Just out of dang nowhere, they come and crash the place.
Yeah, there's what, six of them? It's all the bosses from the first game, which I'm sure was a deliberate, you know, we want to put all the robots from the first game in the first episode.
Yeah, but they only give us the names of four of them. I guess at some point he mentions Brightman. But we mostly just hear Gutsman and Cutman.
Does he mention Brightman? Brightman isn't one of these robots.
Or maybe, I don't see. I didn't even hear what he said, but he said some kind of robot name when one of them gets smashed up and he scoops them into his skull machine.
Oh, that one was Bombman. So maybe that's what he
Bombman.
Said.
Bombman.
Okay,
maybe
Brightman is in the show, but he's not in this episode.
Okay. I'm not super well versed in all of the robot masters. There's too many.
No, I understand. I know these ones, and then I don't really know many beyond the first game.
If it's not Snake Man and Galaxy Man, I don't know them.
Yes, there's like a few that I know because they're cool. So like I know Skull Man because he's rare. And like I know Gemini Man because I think he's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. I know Splash Woman. I can't think of any others. I guess I know Woodman. I already mentioned him.
Airman. Airman has a song.
Airman, yep. Anyway, for the ones that are here now, we have Gutsman, who is played by Gary Chalk, who we've talked about several times. We know him as the voice of Grounder in Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog.
So he's got his niche and he fills it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because he's also King Hippo in Captain N, which is also the same character as this. And he also played Robotnik in Sonic Underground, which is a different character. Fair enough. Yeah. But... And then we have all of the others who are all played by Terry Klassen. He plays Cutman, Elecman, Bombman, and Iceman.
Who don't really say much of anything.
No, not well, Cutman does, but the others don't, no.
That's what I meant. We all know Cutman talks way too much.
Yeah, and it's a very strong Peter Lorre impression.
With pleasure, Gutsman!
For younger people in the audience, you may know Peter Lorre as the guy that they often did impressions of in Looney Tunes cartoons. But Terry Klassen also plays Rush in the Mega Man OVA dub. But he doesn't play Rush in this. And,
okay.
And he plays Junk Data Man in the Mega Man NT Warrior dub. So,
is that a robot master?
I don't know. I don't think so.
Does he shoot adverts at you?
I think he's just like Junk Data.
Okay.
But something I noticed, a lot of the cast in this also reprised... not necessarily their roles, but other roles in other Mega Man shows. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them were also in the Ocean Group Dragon Ball Z dub, the original English dub, I think that was. And this guy played Krillin in that.
Cool.
And he also wrote for that. He has lots of credits for being a voice director in things. You may notice that I did not mention Fireman as being voiced by either of these actors.
Does he just not talk?
Fireman does not talk in this episode and never appears again.
Oh no, Fireman!
It's just a shame. I wonder if it's because he was a bit more complicated to animate because of the flames.
Maybe.
It wouldn't surprise me. But yeah, he appears in this one episode. And he's in the opening to the show, always. But he never appears again, so he never speaks at any point in the show.
Fireman, we just can't afford you. I hope you understand.
So Elec-Man is fighting the TSA robots. And Guts-Man, Fire-Man, and Cut-Man, and Bomb-Man are attacking the airport in general. Ice-Man is here, but doesn't do much. No, wait, Ice-Man isn't here yet, is he?
I don't think he is.
Yeah, that's right. Ice-Man isn't here yet, but he does show up later.
Yeah, and he's like... Like, he's been there all along. Remember our good friend Iceman?
Yeah.
Even Dr. Light didn't remember Iceman.
Dr. Wily and Proto Man are also here, chilling out in some kind of skull flyer above them all. Wily and Proto Man are both played by Scott McNeil, who we've talked about before, because he played Lord Raptor in Darkstalkers.
Oh, yeah.
And he will also go on to reprise his role as Wily in the Mega Man OVA. And he also plays both Gutsman and Cutman in NT Warrior. So I guess Cutman is in Battle Network, but I don't remember him. Scott McNeil has said in interviews and stuff that originally Wily was going to have a British accent, but it was changed to German at some point in production. And according to Joe Ruby, the German accent came from an educational Mega Man anime that Ruby Spears had been asked to dub. And it,
what?
Yeah, it's weird. So in the original version of that, Wily spoke in Japanese with a German accent. So they were like, I guess he should have a German accent. And they changed his accent to German for this show.
Well, as long as it came from somewhere other than within someone's butt.
It's interesting that they cared that much about keeping it consistent, considering what the rest of this show is like.
We're going to put a whole lot of effort into this one specific part of Dr. Wily, and then I don't really care what happens.
Dr. Wily.
When we find that meteor, we'll find Dr. Wily.
I was thinking about that when you made me watch that little 2-minute thing.
I watched that the other day. My favorite part of that whole thing is the part where he says something to Mega Man and you hear him almost say Rock Man and stop and correct himself.
You must recover all the energy immediately, Mega Man.
Oh, so good.
Those are the cutscenes for, I believe, Mega Man 8, by the way, for anyone who doesn't know what we're talking about.
I could never remember where it came from.
I think it's Mega Man 8. It's whatever one was on the PS1. So yeah, Mega Man says once he controls the airport, he controls the city.
Mega Man?
Sorry. Wily says once he controls the airport, he controls the city.
Once the airport is mine, I'll control the city.
Right. That's the only motivation that he ever gives us. He just crashes in here and says that this is the key to controlling the city.
Everyone knows the airport is the true seat of power.
In New York City.
The mayor's just a puppet. The air traffic controller is the real power in the town.
You go, you burst into the mayor's office, you tear off his mask, and it's just an airplane.
I guess he could control immigration to a degree, if he controlled the airport. It's not the only way people come in the country, but it's a way.
It's not the only way people come into New York. It's connected to the rest of the country. It's not a little island nation.
Oh yeah, he just wants to control the city, not the country. I forgot. Right.
I've been to New York. I didn't take a plane to get there. I took a bus. Is Gutsman gonna come to every bus station?
Once I control the bus station, I control the city.
Oh, there's a lot of stops on this line. I hadn't thought this part through. I don't have that many robot masters.
So Cutman... Cutman's just like... It took me a second to realize what he was doing, because he's just like running under the wings of the planes and does a little hop under them, and then the wings fall off. And it took me a second to realize he was slicing them with his scissor head.
Yeah.
Also, like, suddenly these are just actual planes. Earlier it was future hovercrafts, and now it's just regular planes.
You're asking for a lot from this cartoon.
Well, they've designed two different aircraft now. Unless they didn't design these planes. Maybe they were just like, oh, I drew planes. Oops.
Stock footage.
What were you going to say about Cutman?
Cutman's scissors do a lot of strange and interesting things throughout this episode.
Yes. In the game, I believe they just function like a boomerang, right?
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
And not like a heat-seeking missile.
Yeah, well, they seem to be somewhat sentient. I would say that this Cutman is overpowered, because these scissors can cut through anything, and they chase whatever you want to shoot them at until death.
This is somebody's Mary Sue Cutman.
Yeah. So there's a helicopter. Some guys jump in a helicopter to escape, and Cutman slices all the rotors off of it. And only then do the occupants think to radio for help.
Right.
Not when the attack started or anything. Just.
Well, now that they've messed with the helicopter, I guess they're serious.
So this is where they call Mega Man, who seems very casual about the whole thing.
Just another day at Dr. Light's lab.
Yeah. Mega Man is played by Ian James Corlett, who we've also talked about several times. He is the voice of Coconuts in Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog.
No!
Yep. And he also played Victor in Darkstalkers, the Frankenstein.
Okay.
So that's a wide variety of voices, right?
It is.
Are you ready for one more?
Yes.
He's also the voice of Rush in this.
The Scooby-Doo clone?
He is Scooby-Doo, right?
Yes.
I hated it.
You ever feed him Scooby snacks?
Yeah. I found an interview. So, Joe Ruby and Ken Spears, the owners of this studio, were responsible for creating Scooby-Doo. They are the creators of Scooby-Doo. But I found an interview with Joe Ruby where he said that they weren't trying to make Rush like Scooby. And he was almost surprised that people compared Rush to Scooby. So I think this might just be the only way they know how to write a dog.
I guess.
They're just like, what does a dog sound like? Exactly like this. And they eat Scooby snacks. Anyway, we also have Dr. Light here, played by Jim Burns. I think it's pronounced Burns. It's like Byerns.
Oh, yeah. Byerns.
Yeah. We haven't talked about before. He played Joe Dawson in Highlander. He played Inferno in Beast Wars. And he played Lifeguard on Wise Guy. Now, I know that Lifeguard sounds like a credit for an unnamed background character who was a lifeguard.
Yes.
But apparently Lifeguard was the character's actual name, and he appears in 74 episodes.
Oh, no.
So,
okay.
He also reprised his role as Dr. Light in the Mega Man OVA.
Cool.
And we have Roll, played by Robin Ross, who didn't have a very big credit list, but she plays Mrs. Clump in Riverdale. And apparently she also played Stacy in Dead Rising 2. That's the girl who looks after your kid while you go out to kill zombies.
Cool. Why is Dead Rising coming up so much in this episode?
Because it's Capcom.
Yes.
I don't know.
But like, Specifically Dead Rising?
Yeah, I know. It's just a weird coincidence. There's no way they cast her because they were like, hey, you were in Mega Man.
You can only work for Capcom. Once you work for Mega Man, you're stuck here.
I mean, a lot of these people worked on, like, at least three different Mega Man shows.
True.
So Roll was made more present in this show than she is in the games because they wanted to attract more of a female audience.
And that's why they made her the maid.
I mean, she's the maid in the games. But in this...
I know, but in this one, she has a vacuum hand.
She does have a vacuum hand. Yeah.
She has a blender hand.
Oh my god, the blender hand. We'll get to the blender hand. I lost my mind. She's more of a battle maid in this one than it's she is true. In the games. In the games, she really is just a maid.
Yeah.
There's this Met that follows Roll around, apparently named Doc. He only appears in this episode.
Oh.
It's weird, right?
Yeah.
He's following her around for this whole episode. He seems like the mascot character of the show.
Right.
And then apparently he just vanishes after this.
He got a job in a hospital.
It does seem a bit weird, because Eddie is here too, and it did feel like this Met's role could have been filled by Eddie. They're very similar.
They are.
So Roll wants to go and help Mega Man fight the Robot Masters, but he says no because he's a misogynist.
I don't need any girl robots getting in my way!
I love how they really just squeezed in some exposition here when everybody's watching the screen and Dr. Wily and his robots are terrorizing the airport and Dr. Light says,
"We used to work together. You must be stopped, Mega Man."
I say that about all my ex-coworkers. See someone I used to work with at the supermarket using the self-service counter. We used to work together. He must be stopped!
Like later in the same episode, they give us the entire backstory. Why did they think that they needed to add that?
Yeah, it also, them saying it here really makes it feel like he's like, oh, my idiot kids don't remember anything. I better tell them. Hey, remember,
right.
Remember that guy? That's who Daddy used to work with. Remember him? Used to bounce
That's
you on his
Daddy's
knee.
Former lover.
He's taken over the airport.
You can tell because he's painted his big stupid face on all the planes.
Did he do that?
Yes.
I didn't even notice.
After they fix up Mega Man and go back to the airport, we learn that Dr. Wily has spent all this time putting his face on the plane.
That's incredible. So Mega Man's going to leave. He jumps on Rush. And this is when Eddie shows up. Eddie's played by Scott McNeil as well, who's also playing Wily and Proto Man. There aren't a lot of actors in this show.
Mm-hmm.
We've covered the entire voice cast already.
Cool.
And like, there's one guy playing four Robot Masters. So, Eddie's usually red, but they made him green in this show. I don't know why. I'm going to say probably because they already had Rush in red, so they were like, let's make Eddie green, because nobody's green.
And yet all of the Robot Masters are the same color palette, except Cutman.
Yeah, pretty much. Iceman's different.
Well, yeah, but we didn't see him in the beginning.
No.
They forgot to animate him until halfway through.
I guess at least at this point, because Auto didn't exist yet, so at least at this point there weren't any green characters at Light's lab. So I think they probably were just like, let's make him a color that we don't have already. He runs in and he gives Mega Man an energy tank.
Yeah.
And in this show, energy tanks are literally just sodas.
It's just a Monster Energy.
It's just a green soda. I didn't like it. The fact, like, he just grabs this soda out of the air and then he just guzzles it down in a second and then crushes the can and tosses it across the lake.
I mean, he's got his energy drink. Rush has battery biscuits that they feed him.
Yeah. Yeah, the bit, they're like shaped like a dog bone, but they have plus and minuses on each end.
That's how you know it's charged with goodness.
Roll and her little Met friend hop into a ship, and apparently this ship was available as a toy. It's not very memorable to me.
No.
But you could buy a toy of it. Wondering...
Well, now we have to.
I mean, now I feel like I understand why the toy sales weren't great.
You mean because they made toys of luggage robots and a ship that Roll took in the first episode?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure the ship probably stuck around because it was a toy. Wondering if I can find it on eBay and see what it's going for. Well,
$300.
Looks like Guts Man is going for $25 on eBay.
Whoa, we could get a Guts Man.
Mega Man's going for $25 as well. Oh, he looks unfortunate.
Oh no. Has he seen some times, or was he made that way?
You tell me what you think. I can't decide.
Oh no.
What do you think? Made that way or seen times?
He was made that way.
Well, they have a rush in the box. $100.
Why is Rush the most expensive? Oh, I guess in the box.
Rush, NRFB. Rush is not the most expensive. There's a Cutman here for $150.
NRFB?
Yes, I guess.
Don't you remember that episode of Dexter's Lab?
I do, but I don't.
Where he went to the Star Trek convention? Or that was his intended goal, but then he went to the, like, doll convention.
You've ruined the collector's value! Never remove from books!
NRFB! NRFB!
Anyway, we've gotten hung up on toys. Or I have.
That sounds a lot like your day-to-day life.
Hey, just because I spent part of my day searching for a Charmy B action figure... Doesn't mean you know me. So the Met, the little Met guy, didn't he sound like Hubert?
Yeah.
It was weird.
Except he didn't have a disc and a cool leather... What is it? What's the word I'm looking for? I don't remember.
Jacket?
No.
Leather daddy outfit?
Leather daddy outfit.
Oh, Letterman jacket.
Yeah!
There we go. But now I want Leather Daddy Cuba.
I bet he's out there.
Oh god, he's out there.
I mean, look at his face. That is a perfect gimp suit face.
Meow. Anyway, this is when Proto Man sees Mega Man coming and he's like,
"The Blue Bomber!"
Wily calls him the blue dweeb. He calls him that like twice in this episode.
This got me curious about where the Blue Bomber came from. So I looked it up. And apparently, it came from an issue of Nintendo Power. Just like randomly in the review or whatever of the game, they just were like, "Here, you have to help the Blue Bomber get through this." And then Capcom adopted
stuck.
It. Yeah.
Weird.
It seems like originally it was a reference to Rock'em Sock'em Robots.
What?
Because the Blue Bomber is the name of the blue one.
I did not know they had names.
Me neither. The red one's called the Red Rocker, apparently.
The Red Rocker? Yeah. Not even the Red Rocket?
No. Well, that's a dog's penis, Mel.
That's very true. My head is not in the toilet, Mike. I'm not thinking about dog penises.
No, but a dog's head would be in the toilet getting a cool drink. This is where Mega Man steals Bomb Man's weapon. And we know this because Bomb Man is like,
"No, now you've got my weapon."
Right. Because they didn't want to let the action explain itself.
No. They could have just... Because there's a whole animation that plays out of, like, him absorbing the weapon and it going into his brain or something.
Yeah, like the blueprint uploads into his brain and then he gets a bomb arm.
And then they could have just had him fire some bombs. And then I feel like after he did that to a couple of the robot masters, we would understand that he's stealing their weapons.
But now we've understood much quicker. Yeah. Because he loudly announced it.
But, and doesn't someone else loudly announce it later as well? Doesn't Cutman loudly announce it?
Yes, he does.
No! Now you've got my weapon!
So we definitely know that's what's happening.
In case you forgot, during that really long, boring flashback.
Oh yeah, it gets explained properly there too. And they really had no faith in the audience, did they?
Their audience of young boys.
I would have understood. I wasn't a stupid little boy. Okay. Much against what my teachers said.
Unlike what you are now, which is a stupid little man.
Hey, I'm average high. In the games, when Mega Man steals a weapon, he changes color.
Mm-hmm.
So that you can really tell that he's using a different weapon. They didn't do that in this show. He just stays blue all the time.
Yeah.
There's a reason. That was a conscious choice they made.
Why?
They wanted to make the show less visually confusing for the animators. And it cut down on the chance of coloring errors happening.
I guess that makes sense.
Can you imagine, with the kind of budget this show has, if they had, like, 20 identical model sheets for Mega Man where the only difference is his color?
Yeah. Like, as soon as you said that, I immediately thought about that Mario episode. Where
they couldn't even get... The one where they couldn't even get, like, Mario and Luigi's colors right.
The wand colors they kept mixing up.
Oh, the wand colors, too. But that same episode, like, there's that one shot where Luigi's just red.
Yeah.
And that was happening all the time throughout that show. I feel like most episodes have one shot where Mario or Luigi are wearing each other's hat for some reason.
Yeah.
So imagine how often that would... And that's where, like, the two characters don't even look identical. They look similar, but they're not identical. So imagine if Mega Man...
They have different letters on their hats.
One of them's tall and skinny, and the other one's Mario. The Bomb Man just gets blown to pieces.
What the hell does Roll do that she just disintegrates a robot from a distance?
Yeah, she just runs up to Fireman and vacuums him to death.
He just falls apart.
Yeah. Her vacuum arm is overpowered. What if that was Fireman's weakness? Just happened to be Vacuum Buster. Whatever her weapon's called.
Dust Buster. You're dust busted.
Wily is about to blow up Mega Man with ease from his ship. From the comfort and safety of his ship. But Proto Man says,
"No! I must destroy Mega Man. He's my brother."
And that's a bit weird. That's not what Proto Man's personality is in the games at all.
No.
That's what Base's personality is. But Base didn't exist yet when this show was made, so.
And they don't even give us any reason why the two have beef, except Proto Man just wants Mega Man to also be an evil robot.
Yeah, it's just like he just doesn't like his brother for whatever reason.
I'd like you better if you were evil.
Like, I want to say that it's because Wily reprogrammed him to feel that way, but he's clearly not obedient. He disobeys Wily all the time.
Yeah.
So, did he program
him? We'll talk about the robot reprogramming.
But anyway, I was disappointed with Proto Man. Proto Man is my favorite Mega Man character, and this show does not do him justice, in my opinion.
Proto Man sucked. I hated him.
Yeah, he was annoying and dumb. Like Base. I don't like Base very much.
I can see that.
But I love Proto Man, because usually Proto Man is like the loner hero. who shows up and saves everyone and then vanishes again.
He has a cool theme song and he appears and disappears with the wind.
Yeah, he's so cool. And he just shows up at the end and it's like, Mega Man, you done goofed. I'll fix it. And then he leaves again.
I'm the real hero of this series.
And then they're like, Proto Man, come back. Because Proto Man's story in the games, I don't know if he was reprogrammed by Wily at any point. I don't feel like he was. But in the games, his story is that he was the original prototype, just like in this. But he had a defect, which meant that he, at some point, was going to shut down and die. It's some defect with his power source. So Light was going to fix it so that he would be fine and safe. But Proto Man was afraid that fixing his power source, his heart, essentially, would change his personality in some way. So he ran away. Mm-hmm. And he has refused to come back and be fixed. So it's like a sad story because at some point he's going to die. And he knows that, but he's afraid of getting fixed in case it changes him. And all his friends want him to come back and get fixed, but he won't.
Do robot personalities live in their heart?
I don't know. But he thinks they do.
He's running away from a life-changing surgery because he doesn't understand how programming works?
Yeah, basically. I mean, it seems like everybody else seems to be of the opinion that it won't change him and he'll be fine, but he's afraid of it anyway. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that he's wrong. I'm pretty sure that he's running away on a false premise, but still.
It's still tragic nonetheless.
It is. In this, he just got reprogrammed to be a bad guy, and that's it. That's his whole story.
As far as we know so far from episode one, he has no heart condition.
I looked into it and it does seem like that never comes up. It seems like maybe if they had done season three, there's a possibility they would have had him leave Wily and become more of the lone hero type that we know him as. But
they did season three.
Oh, you're right. I think the one season three episode they did is just Wily hijacking a toy factory.
What a good, all-encompassing season.
It really says everything there is to say about this show, I feel like. Cutman cuts a train, and Gutsman throws it at Roll.
And Roll stands there.
She just stands there, and Mega Man shoves her aside and gets crushed instead.
This is literally after she's just disintegrated a robot with a vacuum.
Well, that's why they needed to take her out fast. Although they immediately start ignoring her again, even though they failed to crush her. Because, well, first of all, we get the commercial bumpers, and the art on the commercial bumpers.
Oh, it's good.
It looks like bootleg art of the show.
Bootleg art of a bootleg show.
It looks like art you'd see, like, painted on the side of a traveling fairground ride.
I was going to say painted on the side of a children's daycare.
Yeah. Same vibe. But yeah, once we come back, Roll is running over to check Mega Man's deceased carcass. But all the other Robomasters are just like continuing the destruction, not worried about anything anymore.
Yeah, like, oh, whatever. One chain's probably enough to kill Mega Man. Empirical evidence states that that's true.
Not only that, but when they killed Mega Man, they were trying to kill Roll because she had just disintegrated one of their own with ease. And they're like, oh, we crushed the wrong guy. Sweet. Well,
let's go hassle TSA. I want to get my Sprite onto the plane.
What do you mean I can't take my machete through customs?
It's just 10 bombs.
It's a souvenir. I bought these grenades as a souvenir.
So Roll puts Mega Man on a stretcher and Rush airlifts him to the lab. Again, they just get ignored doing this. Everyone's like, yeah, they're no threat anymore.
Yeah, and to be fair, they aren't.
And I love, as they leave,
Oh, this is so good.
There's like a slow zoom on this one human guy who's just hanging out here.
Like airport security surrounded by robots.
And he says,
"It's all Dr. Light's fault. If he never invented robots, none of this would ever have happened."
Thanks for the exposition, Rando.
What a stupid thing to say. What a just moronic thing to say.
I know.
Like, imagine you're at the bank. And it's getting held up, and you're sitting there like while they go through all the money, and they're throwing it all in bags, and you're in a hostage situation, and you're just like, man, this is all the fault of the man who invented money. If money wasn't invented, this wouldn't be happening.
To be fair, I'm gonna start doing that. Anytime there is an unfortunate circumstance in my life. Like, I get stuck in traffic. I'll be like, this never would have happened if nobody had invented the car.
Next time I'm serving up some sweet chili for everyone and I drop a spoonful of it on the ground, I'm going to be like, God, this wouldn't have happened if nobody had ever invented cooking. There's like 10 different people I could blame that on. Do I blame it on the cooking? Do I blame it on the spoon? Do I blame it on whoever made the first chili recipe?
No, blame it on Sir Isaac Newton for discovering and inventing gravity.
You're right. This never would have happened if Isaac Newton hadn't discovered gravity.
Invented gravity.
Invented gravity, my mistake.
We didn't have gravity before him.
Yeah, the world was wild back then. You could just put an apple in the air and then pick it back up. You were ready for it.
And then it could just fly away to your cousin's house.
Yeah, if you nudged it wrong. God damn it. I put that banana there for later and you've nudged it. Now it's way up there.
Twirling and twirling.
Right, you're getting it back down.
Now that I'm no longer tethered to the planet, I'm free-floating in space. But did you get my banana?
Throw it down. We go back to the lab where Light is operating on Mega Man and giving us some exposition as he does it.
And Mega Man is off in dreamland.
I lost my mind. I couldn't stop laughing when he's lying on the operating table and he just randomly goes,
I'm a little boy.
That's how I dream, out loud, step by step.
I didn't realize it was a dream at this point, so I thought he was
me neither! It wasn't until after the flashback where I was like, oh, that was a dream sequence.
Yeah, but him saying, I'm a little boy, segues into a flashback sequence where Light has just made Proto Man, but when he activates him, he immediately starts wrecking up the joint.
Oh my god, he just walks straight through a wall and starts smashing something?
Yeah, like, no rhyme or reason. Just smashing.
There's no chill on this little boy.
And Light blames it all on Dr. Wily's work and tells him to destroy the plans and start over. What was it, the guidance system or something?
Something like that.
Wily had programmed the guidance system on the robot. So is that... Is that the guy? He turned him on and then Proto Man's GPS was like, walk through wall.
Smash boiler.
In 7 paces, destroy.
Destroy. Destroy. Destroy.
So he tells him to destroy the plans and start again. And Wily says he will in a way that makes it absolutely clear he will not.
You can practically see him twirling his mustache and rubbing his hands together at the same time.
Yes, of course, Dr. Light. You're right, as always. I'll destroy the plans.
Later on, Wily, with all the lights turned off for some reason...
talking to himself...
sneaks in to grab his own plans...
Dr. Light is right behind him. The second Wily picks him up, he's like, I told you to get rid of those!
He turns on the light and he's like... And the funny thing is, like, he turns on the light and he says, I told you to get rid of those. And at that point, Wily could have been like, oh, I am. I'm just about to do it now. But instead, right? He's like, aha!
What are you doing with those plans, Dr. Wily? You were supposed to destroy them. Never!
You'll never stop me, Dr. Light.
And he gets away. He gets away not only with the plans, but also with Proto Man.
It is two old guys running around a lab, so is it that surprising?
Guess not. And he is the wilier of the two.
Dr. Light's just like, oh, my sciatica.
I think he's called Dr. Light because he turned on the lights.
They don't call me Dr. Light for nothing, Wily. I see what you're up to.
So anyway, yeah, this differs from the games because Proto Man had already run away on his own before Wily betrayed Light in the games, I believe.
As he is building the Proto Man that we know, it basically sounds like he's doing it because he didn't get enough toys as a kid.
Well, he says that directly, doesn't he?
Yes.
I never even had toys like the other kids. And now I'll build all the toys I want!
And that's the whole reason he's doing this whole mad science robot master thing.
Yeah. Well, everybody needs a hobby. I guess.
That's also like a really, really weird way to kind of extort your audience. Don't end up like Dr. Wily. Buy your kids Mega Man toys.
I didn't even think of it that way.
If only I had more Capcom toys.
If only my parents had bought me Mega Man action figure. 5-inch. $12.99. Toys R Us.
If I had Roll Ship and One Cut Man, I would have turned out differently.
If only I had Proto Man with reloadable Mega Buster Shot when I was a kid, I wouldn't have stolen a real Proto Man.
Now look what you've made me do. He's taken over the world.
Now look what happened. I control the airport.
This plane has my face on it. You're welcome.
Now, these are my toys.
The human race.
So. 3 months later. Light has built himself a new robot, and he's named it Rock.
Oh, this part was so dystopian to me.
Was it?
So, yes. So Rock wakes up, and he's fully aware of just life in general. He wakes up and he says,
I look human.
And Dr. Light says,
yes, and I programmed you to feel like a human.
And then there's a pregnant pause, and Rock says,
I like that.
And it felt really weird to me. It's like, of course you like that. You've been programmed to like that.
I guess the games go into that a little bit. Because the classic Mega Man of the games does not have free will.
Mm-hmm.
And there's one game where he wants to kill Dr. Wily, and he can't. He can't make that choice.
Mm-hmm.
They changed it for the English version. Where in the Japanese version, Wily points out that he can't kill him, and then Mega Man just pauses as he realizes that that's true. In the English mm-hmm. version, they replaced the pause with Mega Man saying, I am more than a robot! Die, Wily! Which is an odd change to make.
Like, later in this episode, Dr. Light talks about it, and his human emotions are supposed to be what makes him the most super special robot.
Yes, which in the games is what Mega Man X is.
Mm-hmm.
Because Mega Man X was the first robot with the capability of, like, full free choice, I think. I mean, I haven't played most of the X games, but I'm pretty sure that's the whole point of X as a character. Mm-hmm. That he was the first robot that had true, free, full will.
No, it was 1994, Cartoon Mega Man.
Okay, I guess I was wrong. This whole thing is very Astro Boy inspired. Mega Man always has been Astro Boy inspired.
Yeah, but this one just felt really bootleg.
It doesn't quite get into the deeper, darker themes that Astro Boy does. Because Astro Boy was built by a guy who was trying to replace his dead son. So Astro Boy is modeled after the guy's dead son. But then after, I think, like a few weeks of living with him, he realizes that he's nothing like his dead son and abandons him. And it's really dark and it's really dystopian, and you know, it really gets into the heart of like what would it be like to have AI stuff. And that's why I love Astro Boy.
Are you telling me it gets into the heart of what is a man?
A miserable pile of secrets.
That's right.
We don't need that explained. We know. It's the only answer we'll ever need. So the thing you were talking about, because the thing that really stood out to me in this scene was when Light introduces Rock to Roll, and Rock says,
"She's pretty."
And then Light goes,
"You can think of her as your sister."
Yeah, I loved that. They really said it a few times, like, "This is your sister, Rock." Yeah. Remember your sister, Roll?
Yeah, calm down about it. We're not having a Star Wars situation in here.
I was just gonna say, we're not having any Luke and Leia business.
So Light introduces them to Cutman, Gutsman, and Iceman, who haven't been turned on yet.
This is the part I'm talking about.
Okay.
So he introduces us to the robots. They're all just on standby in a little closet. He says, "This is Cutman, a logging robot. This is Gutsman. He's a very strong robot. And this robot can make things cold." He doesn't even name him.
He doesn't even say this, Iceman.
No!
I didn't even note it. I guess because I just know it's Iceman. I didn't even think about it. What was Iceman? I mean, I'm looking up Iceman because I don't remember what Iceman was built for.
Being cold.
Because that's accurate for what the other two were made for in the games, but why did they make Iceman?
He just says he can freeze anything.
Okay, he was created by Dr. Light to perform human-like tasks under extreme climate conditions.
Why does he freeze things?
To create those extreme climate conditions.
I guess, instead of just going where he needs to.
"Listen, I've built a robot that can work in extreme cold. However, due to global warming, this is no longer necessary. So I've also created him with the ability to create the conditions which he is needed to work under."
I'm aware that we're in Puerto Rico right now, and you don't typically deal with Arctic conditions, so I brought my Arctic robot.
Now pay me.
Or I'm going to freeze you and your puny island.
Pay me, I control the airport.
I loved every time either Rock or Roll ask a question or make some kind of statement, Light responds dismissively.
"Just think of all the great things they can do to help mankind."
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Very good, Rock, you idiot. Can't believe I programmed such a moron.
Anyway, Wily shows up suddenly to steal the Robot Masters. And it plays out exactly the same way. I lost my mind when it happened because Wily comes in the dark again. And then Light turns on the lights immediately again. And it's exactly the same.
No, it's slightly different, because this time Dr. Wily has an evil beam, and he fires the evil beam at the robots, and it reprograms them instantaneously.
Yes.
But he doesn't use it on Rock and Roll.
No.
He has to pick them up and take them back to the lab to have a Bond-esque strap-to-the-chair session.
I have that same note. He has them strapped to tables, and he's got like a funny little drill that he's going to use to reprogram them.
Mm-hmm.
But he reprogrammed all the others with a funny ray gun.
In an instant.
Yeah, three robots at once. I couldn't stop laughing. Like, every single line that Lion said, where he used the full words rock and roll, killed me. Yes.
You let rock and roll go! No! Not rock and roll! But why would Dr. Wily want rock and roll?
So good.
He just wants to listen to some Def Leppard, man.
So it's starting to turn into the plot of a rock opera.
Dr. Wily. And then there's just a big guitar solo.
He's kidnapped rock and roll. So Rock stalls by telling Wily there are warrior robots on the way. And Wily believes him because robots can't lie. He doesn't know that Rock is a liar. Oh, I didn't talk about the Rush ad bumper.
Rock, Mega, Mega, right back, messages.
I hated it. It was horrible.
Yeah, it wasn't good. I mean, everything with Rush talking was horrible.
Yeah, I don't think Rush talks in the games. I could be wrong, but I don't think he does.
I don't remember him talking, but I only remember using him as a resource, so.
Well, that's what he is.
I know.
Let's not fool ourselves.
That's not mince words. He is a platform that you use.
Okay, he does. He talks in the anime too, so that's enough for me. I could believe he speaks. I prefer the idea of him not speaking. Oh,
yeah.
Wait, he speaks in at least one of the games. Okay. All right. Okay, so Rush speaks. The quote here from Mega Man and Bass is, "Rockman, I'm here to help, woof."
That's fine.
Yeah, I'm okay with that. Where are we? What just happened? Oh, he's lying.
Right. His robot superpower is lying. If you touch his arm, you absorb the ability to lie.
So they escape somehow. I don't remember how. Do you?
No.
Somehow they trap Wily and Proto Man. They, like, tie him up.
Oh, that's right. That's right. So Rockman goes into another room and he picks up this, like, boiler. It looks like the same thing that Proto Man destroyed as a child. And he just, like, swings it around and rolls it at them, and it hits them. And somehow there's, like, coils on it that perfectly fall and tie them up.
Okay, I can see why I didn't remember this. Yeah, so Rock and Roll escape, and Light tells Rock he's going to rebuild him into a warrior.
And that's what he does.
He upgrades him, and then he renames him Mega Man. That's another thing. Do you find it strange that they changed Rockman to Mega Man, but they still call him Rock?
Yes.
Before he becomes Mega Man?
Yes.
I find that very strange, too. That I checked, and that is true in the games as well, so. Just a strange choice.
I mean, I guess it is just kind of like a weird thing to name your child, and then his superhero identity, but.
You know, I assume that he named his kids Rock and Roll because he likes I mean, all of his robots are named after music, aren't they? In Japanese, Proto Man's called Blues. Rush is a musical name. The bird's called Beat. Dr. Light just likes musical terms, I guess.
I guess.
This is when Light introduces Mega Man to Rush. And there's, like, goofy comedy music that plays. The goofy comedy music plays before Rush has even appeared.
And I've got an added surprise for you. This is Rush. He's going to be your canine companion and transportation.
Mega, Mega!
It's just like, whoa, better hold up. Here comes a comic relief character who doesn't even do anything funny.
Except talk like a dog.
Yeah, it seems like we're expected to find Rush funny because he reminds us of Scooby-Doo, although that apparently wasn't intentional.
I refuse to believe that.
Yeah, it's hard to believe. Roll shows off her new vacuum arm because she's apparently been upgraded too. It really
I know that you
What?
I know that you just spent the last day getting turned into a super warrior, but check out my vacuum hand, huh?
It really doesn't seem that useful, but we already saw Fireman get destroyed by it, so...
Yeah, and later, somebody gets blended to death.
She doesn't show that off here. At this point in the episode, I still blissfully believed it was just a vacuum arm that she had.
And not a tiny weapon of mass destruction.
Yeah. Back in the present, Mega Man wakes up. Mega Man drinks two sodas. At this point, I'm almost surprised that it wasn't a brand deal.
Well, because Ed felt very guilty. He thought it was his fault for only giving him one Monster Energy drink.
Oh, yeah, so that's true. Like, what if it was just Pepsi? Like, I could imagine that. It would almost make more sense.
Yeah.
Mega Man, you died last time because I only gave you one smooth, cool Pepsi.
You died last time because you had a Coke. Take a Pepsi.
This time, take two Pepsis. Remember, kids, drink two Pepsis before you go outside if you don't want to die.
You don't want to get squashed by a train.
Back at the airport, Wily addresses his robots. Fireman is gone and Iceman is here now. Oh, Bombman is gone too. I forgot.
Does he stay gone? I thought he was the one that got blended to death or something.
Was he?
I didn't take any notes of the action. It's just like, no, it's robots fighting.
It's Elec-Man that gets blended.
Oh, okay.
I do have that note. Yeah, Bombman is just gone for the rest of the episode. But he does come back in another episode where Fireman does not.
Bombman got apprehended by TSA.
Fireman's just dead for good. He's just permanently dead.
Yeah.
Wily didn't bother rebuilding him. Oh, you know what? All of these robots were built by Dr. Light. But we only saw Wily steal Cutman, Gutsman, and Iceman. So when did he get Bombman, Elec-Man, and Fireman?
I don't know. The next time Dr. Light turned off the lights.
Yeah, I was just going to say, dude, were there three separate heists? Did they all play out exactly the same? With Wily sneaking in with the lights off and then Dr. Light turning them on and going, "It's you again!"
It's like a horror movie where as soon as you turn the lights off, the shadow appears behind you. It's Dr. Wily and he's come to steal your robots.
Every time you turn off the lights, Dr. Light, I will steal your robots again.
I will be there. I am always there, in the dark, watching.
Behind the trash can. I mean...
So Mega Man shows up. He beats Cutman. And he steals his weapon. And Cutman lets us know. He shoots the scissor gun at Cutman. And Cutman leaps over a helpful brick wall that just happened to be in the middle of the airport. And then goes through a helpful steel vault door that happened to be in the middle of the airport. But the scissors just, like, come through all of them like they're butter.
Yeah, because he's OP. They need to rebalance Cutman.
Cutman sliced up all my steel doors.
But he paid for his hubris, because those scissors chased him all through the night.
Yeah, I don't remember what happened. Oh, doesn't he, like, run to Wily's ship?
Yeah.
And then Wily's like, "No, you fool!"
The scissors! Even though they don't, like, wreck up the skullicopter.
My ship is made of paper, you fool!
Yeah, I don't think they did anything to it. I don't really understand what happened.
No.
Seemed like Cutman just kind of disappeared.
Yeah, maybe we're supposed to believe that the scissors also went into the skullicopter and just, like, snipped his butt or something.
Maybe. Meanwhile, Mega Man steals the ice beam while Rush picks up Elec-Man, and yeah, this is where... So, Rush picks up Elec-Man, and then Roll turns her arm into a blender, and it's like just a regular blender like you might see at a smoothie shop.
Right.
And she just holds it above her head and Rush drops Elect Man into it. And it's horrific. And
he's too big to fit in it. It's not like this is a giant blender. It's a normal size blender.
No,
and
yeah.
It spins around and breaks into a million pieces.
Does this count as imitatable behavior? Can kids do this?
Or did they really want to try something?
Did any kids put their little brother into a blender after watching Mega Man?
Taking inspiration from Roll.
Because usually they're very on top of that. They're like, the sensors don't let you do anything that they think a child might be able to imitate. But then they're just putting people in blenders. Just a regular blender like you might have at home.
And yet they're showing us Wily Coyote painting a very realistic tunnel as if children aren't going to run out and do that. That's imitatable violence.
That's true. But that was made for theaters in the 40s. They weren't worried about it back then. So Gutsman is fighting Mega Man, but then Proto shows up and tags him out. He wants to fight him instead.
So he gets the big hand.
Yeah, and thank God you sent me that gif of that happening, because I did not take that in. I thought there was an animation error where Proto Man had a giant hand for one scene.
Like that Foo Fighters music video where he just has a giant hand.
Exactly like that, yeah. Yeah, in the games Proto Man has a shield, which he does not seem to have in the show.
Well, he has a giant hand. What do you need a shield for when you can punch a problem?
Yeah, I guess Proto Man in the show is also capable of copying his enemy's weapons, which he can't do in the games, I don't think. Mega Man fans, let me know. Does Proto Man copy weapons in the games? I thought he couldn't. I thought he just always had a buster and a shield. But maybe
I'm wrong.
What if
he copied the ability to have a good heart?
That would ruin his entire character arc.
I don't know, I'm all moody for nothing.
Ah, shit. Mega Man pushes him through a jet engine, but it doesn't seem to do anything. Like, he just falls out the other side. Like, was it even a jet engine?
He just got lucky and fell through the blades in a split second.
I guess so. So, but Wily grabs Proto Man and they get away. The mayor is suddenly here at the airport. I know that's the mayor because I looked him up. And he thanks them for their help as Dr. Light's robots rebuild the airport, proving once and for all that this wouldn't have happened if Light didn't invent robots or something. And because that's the thing, like, it feels like the robots rebuilding the airport is supposed to be like, see, robots are good, actually. But they never disproved the guy's point. It wouldn't need rebuilding if there weren't any robots.
That's true.
And Mega Man throws a treat for Rush, and Rush grabs a plane instead that's flying overhead.
And everybody laughs. And then it ends.
Everybody laughs. My least favorite way to end a show.
Yep.
With everybody laughing. Yeah, I hate it so much.
So that's how we're going to end this episode, right?
My favorite thing about this group laugh, though, is that Mega Man, like, awkwardly talks in the middle of it.
Hey, boy.
And it makes it feel like a Stinko Man cartoon.
This whole thing felt like a Stinko Man cartoon.
It really did. I wonder if this is what they had in mind when they made Stinko Man. At least partially, right? It has to be.
Actually, you know what this reminded me of the whole time? Especially Dr. Wily. Blue Laser.
Really? I can see it.
Those loonies are gonna blow up the ocean.
We'll blow up the ocean!
Like, it has the stink of a bad Saturday morning cartoon, because that's what it is.
Yeah.
And that's what Blue Laser is.
It's true. I don't know. I wonder if Stinko Man... We have to look at the OVA, because I wonder if Stinko Man is inspired by that. Because there's definitely some Mega Man inspiration in Stinko Man. It's like dripping with Mega Man inspiration. Mm-hmm. Especially with the game. But I wonder if the Chapman brothers grew up with the Mega Man OVA or something. We have to look at that and see.
I hope they were big fans of just all Mega Man cartoons.
I hope so too. So that's the end. The show is over. Did you enjoy it?
Enjoy is not the word that I would use.
Would you watch more?
Yes.
Yes.
As a means to hurt myself.
I would absolutely watch more. I want to see how other robot masters were interpreted. Because this...
It's not going to be anything like Captain N.
I mean, this feels like... To me, at least, it sure felt like this episode was like, put in every single character so that all of the characters are in the first episode and introduced.
Mm-hmm.
But there are a lot more characters in this show. There are a ton of robot masters in this show that don't appear in this episode.
Does it go through robot masters from later games?
Yes.
Is Snake Man in it?
Do you want me to check right now?
Yes.
I know that...
My favorite robot.
I know that the next episode has Pharaoh Man and Bright Man.
I always forget about Pharaoh Man.
Me too. He's one of the fan-submitted ones, I think. Actually, I think almost all of them were in the later games. I think they pretty much stopped creating their own robot masters and just had kids do it.
We can get the fans to do it for free.
We don't even need to do any work. Yes, Snake Man is in at least 5 episodes.
Yes. He's so dumb.
It says here, aside from Cutman and Gutsman, Snake Man had the most appearances in the series of any of Dr. Wily's robots.
Yes.
Oh, we'll come back and look at Snake Man for you. Don't worry.
He just shoots snakes at you.
I will say, for this show, I was actually surprised how close to the games it was for the era.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you think of some of the other stuff we've looked at, like Sonic the Hedgehog, Super Mario, well, not so much Super Mario Brothers, but Sonic the Hedgehog especially, it's like nothing to do with the game.
Right.
And this was only a year later, and it's way, way closer to the game.
They actually tried.
Yeah, I wonder, it might be because Mega Man had a more established storyline than a lot of games of this period did.
That's true.
Because you think about, Zelda and Mario and Sonic and stuff, they kind of found their way. They didn't really find what their established universe was until... like the late 90s for most of them. Yeah, I feel like 1998 was like the sweet spot for where Zelda and Sonic figured themselves out finally.
But Mega Man knew all along.
But Mega Man, like right from the beginning, yeah, he had a backstory. He had all these side characters with established histories right from the very first game. So maybe that helped them know what they were doing going in.
True.
But like even with a lot of the liberties that have been taken with the designs, they're still recognizable as who they are. You know, you can look at this Dr. Wily and immediately be like, ah, that's Dr. Wily. Unlike
Dr.
Robotnik.
Wily.
Like you look at Robotnik from the Sonic cartoon we looked at. If you didn't know, you know, if you only knew Game Robotnik and you didn't know that this was a Sonic cartoon and you just saw him, would you? I wouldn't have thought that was Robotnik.
Never in a million years.
No. But I can look at this and I can be like, there, that's Dr. Wily. Why does he look weird? As far as legacy goes, I don't think there was really any legacy of this show.
What?
From what I can tell, some characters from it made small cameo appearances in the non-canon gag comics at the back of issues of Archie's Mega Man comic. And that's about it. But apparently, a lot of the background music from this show was reused in the Ocean Dragon Ball Z dub.
Okay.
Which is super weird.
Yeah.
So there's just Dragon Ball Z episodes with Mega Man music playing in the background. Super Fighting Robot! Android 18! I don't have really anything else to say about this show. What about you?
No, not really. It wasn't so bad, but neither was it good.
No, I would watch more. It's definitely not the worst thing that we've seen, but it's far from the best.
Well, we didn't think it would be anywhere near the best. We were just hoping for palatable.
Yeah, I mean, much like what happened with Darkstalkers, I kind of looked at this and the OVA, and I was like, which one do we do first? And I thought, let's do the worst one. But that, I don't know.
What?
Maybe the Mega Man OVA isn't good, but I kind of have pretty high hopes when it comes to an OVA.
Yeah, they put some quality into it.
Yeah, I think... How many OVA have we looked at? Oh, wait. Mars of Destruction was an OVA.
That's true.
Forgot about that.
Wasn't Twinbee an OVA?
Twinbee was an OVA, and Twinbee, I still think, is one of the best things we've looked at so far.
I loved it.
It was
so dumb.
It was very good. I loved Twinbee. We have to come back to that at some point.
We do. It was dumb in the best way.
It was. Still one of our most popular episodes, too.
Bizarre.
Not our most popular episode.
I had never heard of Twinbee before that.
I had heard of Twinbee, but only in passing. I had seen Twinbee on the internet. There's that one Kirby helper that got removed from the DS remake of Superstar because it was a Twinbee reference.
Oh.
Yeah, thanks for joining us, everybody. It was Mega Man.
We had a mega time.
We did. If you would like to support our show so that we can continue making this better or good in any way, you could head over to patreon.com/superbreakfastfriendsclub, where you can give us a little bit of money in exchange for a little bit of extra content that we don't put in the show because it's too funny.
Good sales pitch.
You can also find us at coffee.com/superbreakfastfriendsclub. You can tweet at us at sbreakfastfc on Twitter. I'm Skull Pirate Mike, and I stream on Twitch.
I am the quiet whisper that you hear at the back of your head when you're trying to convince yourself not to do that horrible thing, and I tell you do it.
I thought that sounded like you.
I tried to change my voice, but you know all my voices.
Yeah. Well, yeah. You just spent so long doing that Dr. Wily voice today. I was like, oh, there it is.
Yeah, it's just a darn coincidence that we happened to watch the one show that I took inspiration from for my sinister whisper voice.
Do it. Do the thing.
Just do not turn on the light.
No, my weakness.
My weakness. Somebody seeing the evil thing I'm doing.
Thanks for joining us, everybody. Oh, look at that stupid thing that our dog is doing. Silly dog. It's probably good enough.
Probably.